So friends, a cyber security strategy is similar to our biological immune systems. That we can see in our current slide as well. Threats grow in complexity even when our defenses respond to contain them. A healthy cybersecurity ecosystem is vital to ensuring that our business stay protected from all the attacks. A healthy cyber security ecosystem will ensure all components are working integrated together, and that too in a real time. And that will help us to anticipate and prevent any cyber attacks, limit the attacks while spreading, mitigate if there is any consequences, and restore the systems and network to a trusted state. It's a hard to ignore the similarity between the cybersecurity system and our biological immune system. Just like our body, threats grow in a complexity, even as the anatomy defenses response to contain them. With each attack, the immune system learns to improve its response to the attack. In both the cases, keeping the component part of immune system's deficiency in check-in is the key to ensure a robust response and rippling attack. Hi, my name is Shailendra Srivastava, and it's my pleasure to be here and presenting you a subject which is actually a core to my heart, which is cyber immunity. Friends, in this presentation, I will be covering the cyber risk as well as basically I will initiate with human immune system, and also I will try to compare what we can learn from human immune system, because of course that has been design and architecture is our God. So there are so many things we can learn from our existing human systems, and of course there is a lot of way we can improve our cyber immune security system by learning them. Right, so I will go through all these things. I will try to explain the function design. I will try to explain the principle and the architecture, and I will also try to touch some hacking hacking tricks. Probably I will try to explain certain ways, certain terminologies which may be known to everyone, but I want that to be introduced or that to be explained in this session, because that are more relevant to explain in this session. So this is the overall agenda or overall things what I'm going to do in next couple of hours. So why cyber immunity? Friends, we should understand that the people have been searching immune system nowadays like anything. If you Google it, people are searching like what is immunity, how we can improve our immunity, right? And what the things we can do if to increase our immunity. And it is very trending nowadays in a Google. So what happening is, people who are like we are in practicing of cyber security have been always trying to relate ourselves to what's happening in today's in the pandemic situation. Couple of things which are common, like how we are learning and adopting from the pandemic management. Human immune systems also talking about viruses. We also have day in and day out talking about viruses, malware. Human immune system, friends, I will be representing this as a HIS in future. So human immune system, HIS, also talking about malware, doesn't have any vaccines. They may be finding it once in a while, but in our case, it's almost every day we find viruses which doesn't have any signature. So clearly we always think that there are so many things where we can kind of a dual symbiotic relationship, like we can take something from the human immune system and they can also take something from our cyber immune system, and all for the betterment and the sake of our world. Modeling the human immune systems, which is the bio-inspired computing, is not very uncommon, friends. It has been always there, and it has been a huge success, including the artificial intelligence we are talking about today in modern era, is actually a bio-inspired computing. What I'm talking to you is precisely a bio-inspired cyber immune systems now, and trying to mimic the human immune systems and how to improve and make cyber immune system more robust. Friends, so what the problem definition for us? The problem definition for us is like in cyber world, as I indicated earlier, most of our threats are zero-day threats. The zero-day threat means that threat for which there is no vaccine or no signature, or there is nothing or no patch available so far. We find those days are gone when we are having a already signature is just a matter of patching or matter of rolling some kind of a security tools. And that were fair enough for to secure our security environment. Now in today's, most of our threats are unknown. Most of the threats are zero-day threats, and there is nothing or very minimal where if we called as a known vulnerability threats. In IoT or Internet of Things or OT, operational technology interaction is going to increase day by day. Why? Because of digital transformation and because of business need. And as you know, COVID is a kind of a catalyst for us. We were working earlier in our office, and if we ask our boss to work from home, they might show some resistance. But nowadays, it's in our daily practice. In fact, companies are thinking to promote the work from home culture. So, for us to do the digital transformation has all over world is really fast, and that too because of a COVID. It may sound a little poetic, but that is the fact. Because COVID, we have been working remotely and we have been allowing to access our resource from different kind of endpoints, from different kind of network, which is precisely what we are trying to do otherwise as well. But it was on a slower pace. Also, it's a matter of taking some time, but now is been very faster. Friends, what happening to an additional solution? For example, we have a firewall, we have an antivirus, we have an intrusion prevention system, intrusion detection system. They have been there and they have been to their best of the time. But we need to really think through, and we need to really relook those things. They may have been very sufficient. They may be essential service, but I don't think in the present context, in the present scenario, they are sufficient enough. So there is a need to look out that, and we honestly need to have some kind of a solution which is self-learning. And because of zero day, because of unknown content in all over scenarios, so we have a solution must have which has this kind of a capability, what we called as a self-learning. Now I'm moving to the next slide. So, friends, I will just talking to you about the human. What is the design of human immune systems, and how do we really mimic the human system to get a cyber immune system? So, if we look at the human immune system here, we'll be having, always similar kind of issues. We have a threat. We have a threat free world. So we look at a human immune system, and all of us are always surrounded by so many threats. A threat free world, if you are thinking, and that is a utopian concept. Everywhere there is a threat. Friends, I just want to mention here, threat doesn't mean risk. When threat coupled with any vulnerability, then only that comes or consider as a risk. So here I'm just talking about threat, right? So don't confuse with risk. Now, wherever you go, threat is there. Threat will be like viruses, carcinogens, pollution, germs, parasites, etc. And similarly, in our cyber immune systems, there are some cyber threats, also like social engineering, phishing, vishing, trojan. So these are some kind of a threat we have in our cyber immune system. Now, despite of we all are having so many threats, it was observed that the people sometimes fall sick very frequently, sometimes people fall sick very rarely. So why these things are happening? Despite of all these variety of threats, why everyone may fall sick frequently or a few people are not falling sick that much frequently? Some of the human fall sick may be depends upon their immune systems. So why is happening is because we all have a natural mechanism to detect and prevent these kind of threats. So what kind of these natural mechanism we have? We have a natural mechanism what we call as the so basically that natural mechanism is nothing but the immunity, its actual ability to resist infection or disease. Or let's try understand little more about this immunity. So what immunity is, actual immunity is? See, actual immunity basically prevent access of any pathogen to our body. Friends, here I'm talking about human immune system, and neutralize or eradicate any kind of a infection. It constitute molecules, organs, cells, tissue, and etc. And these are basically parts of our human body. These are our insides of our human body. Now, we have something called immune response. This is very important for us to understand, friends. So that being forward, we should be able to have a better immune response system in our cyber immune system. So understanding the human immune system is very important, because once we understand this, probably that will help us to create our own cyber immune system much better. Now, immune response is nothing but very coordinated, orchestrated actions of the host immune system, which is inside the body, and which consists of, as I mentioned earlier, tissues, cells, and all sort of things, which actually fight to any foreign agent or pathogens. It actually understands what is required and find the strategy and start fighting to it. It happened in very efficient, very fast, and self-learning way. Friend, this is the keyword, self-learning way, right? So let's try to understand type of immunity what human immune system has. And friends, maybe you guys are thinking that I'm talking about human immune systems continuously, but this is what I want to explain you in detail, so that when I am explaining you security or the immune system of a cyber security or cyber immune system CIS, then you will try to relate. We have an innate immune system in human immune systems, and now how we are adopting this from HIS. So that's why I'm trying to explain here in more detail. So broadly, we have two type of immunity. First is innate immunity, and second is acquired immunity. Let's try to understand one by one what is innate immunity. Innate immunity is something which is a kind of inherited bias once a person or a human being born. So these innate immunity is coming by birth. They are born with certain immunities, and that immunity remain inside the body of our human being, and this react very quickly, as this will be considered as first and second line of defenses of our body. That means from this we can understand in our cyber immune systems we also have some kind of a immunity which can be considered as a first and second line of defenses, and that too comes as a very basic thing. I mean, what we consider as an MBSS or minimum baseline security for any servers or any asset. Right, so I'm just giving an example. Now, where if something happens, it will start fighting. Sometime it will win, sometime it got defeated. So you can see responses like in our mucous membrane, inflammation, fever. So all this happening because of this innate immunity. So innate immunity is present in all human, which in biological terms, if you call it, that is a Homo sapiens, and this kind of inherited and is present since birth. And this is our first and second line of defenses. Whenever something comes, it fight. It doesn't understand what it is, just fight. It's not like our surgical operations. Whenever something comes, it fight. Second kind of immunity is acquired immunity, which is the adaptive immunity. This is very specific. It is like a surgical operations. Sometimes something happens, and this immunity will fight with these pathogens, and what to happen is a reaction, either win or lose. Now here we have a very classic quality. We have something called a memory. So whatever action has been taken for any incident, that always register in a memory inside the human body, and that we call as an antibodies. So this immunity have a memory. So that means in our security or in cyber immune system, will be having some kind of a mechanism where we register what kind of incident happened or any kind of attack happened, if that is not been contained, or if that is, I mean, how we have what kind of action we have taken. So in our cyber immune system CIS, we must be having this kind of a mechanism as well. So this is a second learning what we can have from the human immune system, right? There must be a entry of all the parts. Either we have won or we got defeated. So this is known as so this is known to our body that what kind of a pathogen which came, and that is why I fight or I fought earlier. So next time, if any kind of attack happens, I know what to do, right? So acquired immunity is something which acquire over time because of is keep learning a nature, right? And these acquired immunity get stronger day by day. That means from this human immune system, we can understand that in our case, in our cyber immune systems also, we must have some kind of a component or mechanism where whatever happened, that memory or that kind of a signature got incremented day by day, and our database of all this incident get stronger and stronger. So next time if any kind of attack happened, we know what we did last time and how we can fight this time. So in human immune system we have innate immunity as first and second line of defenses, and acquired immunity here in this case is third line of defenses. And here if I'm talking about acquired component, then we acquired immunity component, then we have two kind of a component. One is antigen presenting cells and another one is B cells and T cells. Now what happens, friends, if any immune systems fail? So if these kind of systems fail in a human being, then these will appear as an allergy, some autoimmune diseases or immunodeficiency diseases. I don't go in deep into these biological terms, as we all know what is allergy happening, what human immune system is not working well. Though in IT we can think of autoimmune disease as false positive. So we can relate this as a false positive when talking about our cyber immune system. Sometimes what would happen is our immune system think your own body as an alien or outsider and try to attack certain systems, and which cause some disease like arthritis and all. So many diseases like this, which are autoimmune disease, in that disease, immune systems mistakenly think that human body or some of the component are foreign bodies and try to attack them as well. So this is how we can relate with our false positive thing, where there are certain attacks which are legitimate, or we are considering those as not legitimate or vice versa. So in a whole, there is an immunology which consists of immune systems and immune response. Immune systems falls into autoimmune disease, allergies and immunodeficiency diseases, and immune response is innate immunity, that is first and second line of defenses, and acquired immunity is the third line of defenses. So friends, let's try to understand the design basic of human immune system first. So broadly, if we try to understand, the HIS is like what we call have a defense in depth. What does it mean? It means that nothing is like in one control, right? We'll be having a multiple layers of controls, or we can say there is a nothing like one controls take care of the entire system, or one risk. There are multiple controls, or one risk, and all these controls are very well integrated and orchestrated. One control knows what other control is doing. That is first and crucial basic design basis of our human immune system. So this is a very good lesson learning for us if we are talking about our cyber immune system. See, in our cyber immune system, the basic challenges will be having the integration. See, we have five different solutions. All solutions is been designed by different architects. So their thought process, their working the pattern, their way of coding or integration is different. So it might happen, or in majorly cases happens, that these integrations have some lags, some gaps, and that's what we need to improve here. That's what we need to understand with our human immune systems, that one control, there must be a one control who governs all other controls, and that too, that first and crucial basic design. If the control is working properly, or if one controls or one layer of control is not knowing what other layer is doing, then of course the integration is used. So that is the very important thing we should learn for our human immune system. I will be explaining this in more detail in the subsequent slides. The second is, there is an efficient whitelisting approach, which means that in our human a system understanding what consists a human being, what are the characteristics of being a human. If there is any change happen in human being, it will find out that if this is something new or if that's something different. It may be his nature, it may be his food habit or something, right? So that may give our human immune systems a kind of a signal that do I need to fight it, either by doing a surgical operation, because of the memory cells is saying, hey, this kind of a thing happened earlier also, or either I will do a generic fight, I mean the our first layer of defense. Then after every immune system fight, they actually create a signature, and a signature on the fly, I mean while doing the fighting itself. When every fight happens, a signature is created. That means next time if fight happens, our human immune systems is very much aware, and he will be having a very skilled soldier for next time, because they know the signature, they know what kind of action to do. So here we can understand, in case of our cyber immune systems, that we must be having some robust a kind of a technology or a process where we can put these kind of effort, how to make certain things whitelisting or blacklisting, or in case of any unknown vulnerability, what we call a zero day, we should know how to prevent them, or what other things we should do to avoid zero day, and how we can create a signature of unknown vulnerabilities as well, right? Because that's going to be helpful whenever in case of any next time similar kind of attack happen. So there are visible symptoms when immune system do not work optimally. There are a way to enhance the effectiveness of immune systems also, the systems as well. So if in case something is not going good in our human immune systems, will be having a way where they can enhance the effectiveness. Now in our human immune system, we can do meditation, yoga, and we can take some medicines and all. So that's how we can increase our immunity and all, right? Now let's talk about cyber immune systems, and we'll talk about what are the challenges in our cyber immune systems, and that too in, if I compare, I mean I was trying to compare while explaining, but let me try to compare here explicitly while explaining the cyber immune systems and human immune systems. It is very important for us to understand this. So when in integrated defense in depth, we always have a defense in depth, but integration of all the controls is very difficult things in cyber immune system. Why? Because we have multiple applications, we have multiple solutions, we have so many integration or complex integration, right? So to show integration or to work with all these integration together, or to fight in any circumstances where any attack is ongoing, that is actually very challenging. So mostly so as I said, in our cyber immune systems, because of this multiple solution, multiple different type of architecture, is difficult to manage that defense in depth. But as I said, in human immune systems, we can do, because we have a one control, and organs or all the human bodies are being designed by one architecture, which is our God. So that is something which we need to understand for how we can improve our integration here. Now again, in terms of whitelisting approach, in like we know, I mean is going to be in our human immune systems, that is going to be a very effective or self-learning way. But here in our cyber immune systems, we have a very dynamic environment. multiple architectures are there, and we also have end of life, end of support service kind of systems. So environment is changing every day. So to consider things, or consider any asset, or consider any attack, or as a and allowing or not allowing, is something which is a bit complex. So that is how what we need to work on if I'm talking about comparison with human immune system. So friends, whitelisting approach in cyber systems concept is not very successful in IT systems, because we have a very dynamic environment. As I said, we have many versions. In fact, one software must be having a 4 or 5 versions. That again makes a complexity. We need to test any patch in there in a testing environment and a development environment. Then even developers also threatened if we put that patch in a production, then if something goes bad, then what will be the what will be the solution of those things if something goes bad in production, though those patches were successfully applied in testing and development environment. So we have some kind of issues also, and that too because of mismatching of persons. So if on a whole, if you can say, it's very difficult to maintain all of these terms, and it's very difficult to do in every things in a whole, if I'm talking about cyber immune system. Now if I'm talking about end of the life support for our human being, we can have some kind of a prescription. If I'm telling that probably a doctor can recommend that above let's say anybody who born before 1940, they are considered as an end of the life human, because there are no medicine left for them. They have to do certain kind of a practice, because there must be some kind of rejection happen if we take certain medicine after certain age and all. So that kind of a thing we can consider if I'm talking about human immune systems. But in our CIS, if you think we will be having a end of the life systems, and that too we can find it very easily. Vendors will declare when will be the end of the support or end of the life going to happen, so we can have sufficient time. We know what kind of things we need to do, and even if something which is not in our control, I mean if you want to continue the vulnerable systems, then we know the mechanism how we can prevent in case of anything happen. We have certain tools who can prevent even if our end of the support or end of the life systems are in productions, right? So that too we know we have a we have mechanism. We know how to create a signature of any vulnerabilities, but that's going to be that's going to affect the performance of that system. So it's better if we can if we can switch to the latest version or the latest system or latest OS of that machine. So if we learn from the attack on a real time and create a signature on the fly again, so let me tell you that this has become difficult in our case. Our case means in case of a CIS. Why? Because of integrity problem, and we don't have a zero-day issue. If in case it's going to happen in a once, then yes, that will be fine, that we can manage. But in our case, we have almost every day we have a zero-day attack, which is happening so far. And understanding the attack and creating the signature on a daily basis for so many or thousands or lakhs of attacks is going to be very difficult. But there is a way to do that. We can prevent from the zero-day attacks as well, because there is a visible symptom when even system doesn't work in more or less the same way as we have a human immune system, we also have a lot of visible symptoms, like we have a false positive. There will be a misbehavior of any system. They may not work as appropriately. So these are some indications, some behavior through which we can find out that there is something fishy. So we know that this is not functioning well, and hygiene is not at all good. And there is a way to enhance this immune system. If patching is equivalent to vaccination, but patching is happening almost every day, but vaccination may happen in a certain interval, probably once in a year or twice in a year. And we have to update signature every day, many times, on a daily basis. But in case of a human immune system, we'll be having a 0 day, let's say COVID-19 is coming once in a while. So that in that case, HIS is much lucky, I would say. Now friends, so what should be the functioning if you really want to design a cyber immune system? We should always do a continuous do risk and trust assessment. Two layer of defenses we would have as a layer of defenses. I will tell you, we must have trust and risk assessment in every layer, and that too in a way of what we have in HIS, where we are trying to do each layer of each layer would understand what other layer is doing. So this is what we are tracking, or we are tracing for our HIS. Every layer, every defense system should know what other layer is doing and do a continuous risk and trust assessment, and all the layer will talk each other, and first layer of defense is to give the immediate solution, right? And that solution is like given by the antiviruses, firewalls, etc., which is there to prevent from any known threats. And in second line of defense is, let's say, 0 day, which can be preventable today. There are solutions which is mostly based on our behavior. In fact, gateway and endpoints, there are mechanisms which prevent mostly the 0 day, but sometimes they cannot even prevent a 0 day. And that's why we have a third line of defense to handle these kind of things, which will be called as an adaptive. So adaptive approach, here we are coming as a third line of defenses. Friends, this is what we are tracking from HIS, where again we have an adaptive approach in our human immune systems, where our body is trying to learn or memorize by their existing attacks or any previous attacks, right? So third line of defense will be our adaptive approach, and that will become acquired immunity for us. And once in third level defense is which is there to behave was to acquire immunity, that will give a continuous feedback to the layer of defenses, that means our first line of defense and second line of defense, to create a signature. So we'll be attacked by a certain attacker where no signature was there, that was a 0 day attack, but we have a third layer who try to adopt and send the detail to first and second line of defenses, so that they can memorize and create a signature, and that too in a similar way of HIS on the fly. That means whatever third line defenses do, they let inform the first and second line and a line of defenses, and to know that what's going to do in the next time if same kind of attack happen, and it will not necessarily come to tell third line of defenses next time, because now the first and second line of defenses know they have a signature already in place. and the security should be a part of it, and this kind of a security should be part of all systems and should include identification, protection, detection, response and recovery. It must have a strong response and recovery mechanism, because in today's world, identification of protection or detection is not that much imminent, because nowadays these things are coming very frequently. So the important point here is how we respond and recover from it. We have to make sure that we never fail to get up, which has to be our recovery and response. Friends, now I'm sharing with you a kind of a model that will try to explain you the first line of defense, second line of defense, and third line of defense, what we can propose as a cyber immune system. So here, if you can see, as I explained to you earlier, the firewall or antivirus intrusion detection systems, IPS, etc., will be considered as our first line of defenses, and in our second line of defenses will be the anti-malware, web applications, firewall, etc. Now, what happens in today's world, in any organization, any threat which comes, there is a gateway. There are all zero-day defense systems, and there sometimes those got detected and sometimes not spotified by any antivirus, and in our endpoints or antivirus sometimes may detect, sometimes not. So in the process, what happened is, let's say we find something in our gateway while it was coming and it was not detected by the endpoint. So in that case, what we can do? So in that case, field used to do so in that case we need to let our vendor know, like for which we are using any antiviruses or any endpoint protection, that these kind of attacks or these kind of vulnerabilities are coming in our environment, and this seems to be suspicious. So we let our endpoint vendor know, and we inform vendor that there are some kind of attacks coming through the gateway, and your solution is not able to catch them, right? So vendor probably in most of the case they try to do the investigation, they analyze, and they create a signature. So that's how in case of a zero day, in case of an unknown vulnerability, where we don't have any signature, we have a signature in place. And these kind of a practice being shared by multi-organization. I mean, it's not only one organization is sharing with a vendor, we'll be getting the same kind of a detail by multiple organizations. And that's how the vendor can create a signature and make their system more robust, right? So this is how we can create a signature of our zero-day attacks. So friends, that third line of defense will help in creating signature, and that is being used by the first and second line, and that too in a way that becomes more becomes as a HIS, what we call as an acquired immunity. So you have innate immunity and acquired immunity threats, and this kind of a process can be functional or make our cyber immune system or cyber security system more robust. Friends, now I'm trying to explain some kind of vulnerabilities. Friends, hackers have been known to take the time to study the systems used by a target in order to identify any vulnerability. For instance, if I'm saying WikiLeaks have often said that the National Security Agency, NSA, does the same thing, and so far a database of vulnerabilities exists on computing device, commonly used software systems and even everyday devices. Their stored exploits have been outed by a hack tool called the Shadow Brokers, who regularly leak some of the vulnerabilities that the agency kept. Some of the previously released vulnerabilities have been used by black hats to create powerful malware such as a WannaCry. To summarize, there are hacker groups and many other government agencies studying software systems to find more exploitable vulnerabilities. The exploitation of vulnerability is done when hacker take advantage of bugs in a software system. This could be written, this could be within an operating system, the kernel, or a web-based system. The vulnerability provides loopholes through which hacker can perform malicious actions. These could be errors in authentication code, bugs within the account management system, or just any other unforeseen error by the developer. Software systems developing constantly give user update and upgrade as a response to the observer or report bugs in their systems. And this is known as patch management, which is a standard procedure at any organization that specializes in making a robust system. Friends, I have already explained the zero day, but let me just quickly walk through this. As it has been mentioned, many software developing companies have rigorous patch management systems, I have just explained, and therefore they have always updated their software whenever any vulnerability is discovered. This frustrates hacker because their hacking efforts targeted at exploiting vulnerability that software developer has already patched. And then adaption to this, hacker have discovered a new term or the new vulnerability, what we call it as a zero-day attack. The zero-day attacks are advanced vulnerability discovery tools and techniques to identify vulnerability and that are not yet known by the software developers. Some of the common use tools and techniques implemented by hacker to find zero-day vulnerabilities are as follows. So here I'm just trying to explain some of the tricks or the some of the tools used by the hacker. So one is what we call as a phishing. So this involves the recreation of a system by the hacker in an attempt to find a vulnerability. Through fuzzing, hackers can determine all the safety precautions that system developer have to put into consideration. That is very important point, friends. And the type of bugs that they had to fix while making the systems. An attacker also have a higher chance of creating a vulnerability that can be successfully used against module of the target systems. This process is effective since a hacker gain a full understanding of working of the systems as well as where how it can be compromised. So hacker is getting what will be the existing environment, what are the existing systems, and they also know how to compromise it. However, it is often too cumbersome to use, especially when dealing with large programs. Right. So friends, next one is source code analysis. So basically friends, this is being done by a system that release their so this has been done by a system that release their source code. And in this case, this has been shared to the public or through open source under BSD or GNU licenses. A knowledgeable hacker in the language used to code a system might be able to identify bug in the source code, and this method is simpler and quicker than phishing. However, its success is slower since it is not very easy to pinpoint error from just looking at code. Another approach is to use a specific tool to identify vulnerability in the code. And Checkmarks, you can check it, www.checkmarks.com, checkmarx.com is an example of that. Checkmarks can scan the code and quickly identify, categorize and suggest countermeasures as well for all the vulnerabilities possible in that code. Friends, even if you don't have an access to the source code, it is still possible to obtain some relevant information just by performing a reverse engineering analysis using tools such as IDA Pro. IDA Pro is a programmable, or IDA Pro is a complete integrated development environment. And this is an example. You can see in IDA Pro is a deassembling a program called evil.exe. For further analysis that has been disassembling code can reveal more details with what program is doing, right? So using this deassembling program, they can try to find out the if there is any vulnerability or any scope of any exploitation. Now friends, type of zero-day exploit. There is no doubt that protecting against zero-day exploit is one of the most challenging aspects of everyday operation. We have, or if you guys are knowing that we have a blue team also who do these kind of things. However, if you know the behavior and not know how it works, it will help you to identify the pattern and potentially take action to protect the system. Now, in following slides, we'll be giving you more details about different type of zero-day exploits. We have something called a buffer overflow. So buffer overflow are caused by the use of incorrect logic in the code of system. The hacker will identify area where these overflow can exploited in a system. They execute the exploit by instructing a system to write data to a buffer memory. So basically here his purpose is to fill the buffer, but not to observe the memory restriction of the buffer. The system will, of course, end up writing data past the acceptable limit, which will therefore overflow to parts of the memory. The main aim of this type of exploit is to cause the system to crash, and that to be in a controllable way. It is a common zero-day exploit, since it is easy for an attacker to identify area in a program where an overflow can happen. Attacker can exploit existing buffer flow vulnerability in an unpatched system. Friend, this is something which you can try. If some patch is not been applied, then probably you can try to exploit that vulnerability. For example, if you can try I'm just sharing the vulnerability code CVE-2010-3939 address the buffer overflow vulnerability in the win32k.svs module, and that is in kernel mode drivers of the Windows 2008 R2 version, right? So that is the vulnerability. So that's why most of the people, this could be one of the reasons are switching to the latest was. And in fact, if I'm not wrong, 14th January 2020, this 2008 is already been end of life and end of support, right? So if somebody is working on this OS or server, please it's recommend to switch to the latest OS. Structured exceptional handler overrides. Friends, SEH is an exceptional handling mechanism including most programs to make them robust and reliable. It is used to handle many type of error and any exception that arises during the normal exception of an application, like SEH exploit happen when exception handler of an application is manipulated, and that is caused it to force an application to close. Hacker normally attack the logic of SEH, causing it to correct non-existing error and lead a system to a peaceful shutdown. This technique is something are sometimes used with buffer overflow to ensure that system brought down by overflow is closed to prevent unnecessary and excessive damage. Now, friend, try to understand the steps to compromise the systems. We have deploying payloads. We require to deploy certain payloads. Now, assuming that the entire public recon process was done to identify the target that you want to attack, you now need to build a payload that can exploit an existing vulnerability in the systems. Now, in the upcoming study, we'll go over some of the strategy that you can implement to perform this kind of operation. We require to deploy the payload. So installing and using a vulnerability scanner, right? So here we have, we can use some of the scanner, like we can use the Nessus vulnerability scanner, and as I mentioned previously, any attack must begin with a scanning or snipping tool that is a part of the recon phase. Nessus can be installed into hacker's machine using the Linux terminal with a command apt-get install Nessus. After installing Nessus, a hacker will create an account to log in into in order to use the tool in future. This tool is then started on Backtrack and will be assembled from the local host, for example 172.0.0.1 at port 8834 using web using any web browser, right? So that tool require Adobe Flash to be installed in the browser, and that's all. That is opened in. From there, it gives a login prompt that will authenticate the hacker into full functionality of the tool. In the Nessus tool, there is a scanning functionality in a menu bar, and this is where a user enters the IP address of the target. There are to be scanned by the scanning tool and then either launch an immediate or a delayed scan. The tool gives a report after scanning the individual host, and then the scan was carried out on. It will categorize vulnerabilities into either high, medium, or low priority. It will also give the number of open ports that can be exploited. The high priority vulnerabilities are the one that hacker will usually target, as they easily give them information on how to exploit system using an attack tool. So friend, using this tool, if somebody is having a control, then it's just a matter of his time and effort. He will be knowing all the vulnerabilities in any server or any machine with a minimal effect, effort. Now, at this point, the hacker installed an attack tool in order to facilitate the exploitation of the vulnerability identified by the Nessus tools or any other scanning tool, for example. Now, the following figure I'm going to show is a screenshot of a Nessus tool displaying a vulnerable report of a previously scanned target. So here you can see foreign host 192.168.1.28, total 136 were vulnerabilities were there, which is out of which 11 are high, mediums are 18 and lower 84, and there are 23 ports which were open, and that is being used using the Metasploit. The Metasploit has been selected as the attack tool because most hacker and penetration tester use it. It is also easy to access since it comes pre-installed into Backtrack Linux distributions as well as for Kali Linux. Since exploitation keep on being added to the framework, most users will update it very time they want to use it. The framework controls can be booted up giving the command msf console in the terminal.
Yeah,
Now, friends, the MS App consoles we have has a hive of exploit and payloads that can be used again against any different vulnerabilities that a hacker has already identified using a different scanning tool previously, as we discussed previously, right? So there is a search command that allow user of the framework to narrow down their result to particular exploit. Once one has identified a particular exploit, all that is needed is to type the command and the location of exploit to be used. For example, the payload is then set up using the command set payload, which is with the following command, that is Windows slash meta meter Peter, for example, this is the name of the person, and that and followed by the name of that payload. Now, after the command is been given, the console will request the IP address of the target and deploy the payload. Payload are the actual attacks that the target will be getting hit with. The following discussion will focus on a particular attack that can be used against Windows. Now, the following figure, if you are seeing, is shows Metasploit running on a virtual machine trying to hack into Windows based computer that is also running in the virtual environment. Now, another way to generate a payload is by using a MSF Venom command line interface, and MSF Venom combine MSF payload and MSF encode in a single framework. In this example, we are creating a payload from Windows command shell. Reverse TCP stager, this start with a platform using hyphen p Windows, using the local IP address as the listed IP 192.168.2.2, port 45 as the listen port, and the executable file do.exe as a part of the attack. Once the payload has been created, you can distribute it using one of the methods that were mentioned previously, including what we discussed, using the some kind of a phishing email as well. So that is how we can do this by using the our scanning tools. Now let's talk about some hacking techniques in addition to the mentioned tools. So for hacking, the APTs are commonly known to employ the following hacking techniques. First one is called as a sniffing. So basically, in sniffing is a program or device that can monitor, or what we can as a sniff, data traveling in a network. A sniffer can be used both for legitimate network management functions and for stealing information from a network. Unauthorized sniffer can be extremely dangerous to the network security because they are difficult to detect, making it one of the favorite weapons in the hacker's arsenal. Decryption is known to everyone, and just touching this topic, decryption is the process of converting encrypted data back to its original form so it can be understood. Now, friends, encryption and decryption should not be confused with encoding or decoding, in which data is converted from one form to another, but it is not deliberately altered so as to conceal its content. Cross-domain technique is utilized to manually or automatically access or transfer information between two or more differing security domains or network. These are integrated systems including hardware and software that enable transfer of information across domain. Reverse engineering. Friends, reverse engineering is a process of extracting design information for electronic exploitation. The process often involves deassembling an electronic component or computer program and analyze its content. From a cybersecurity perspective, this task is generally performed with the intent of circumventing electronic across restrictions. SQL injection. So sequential query language injection or SQL is a programming language designed for managing data in a relation database management system, that is Oracle, SQL Server, etc. And SQL is a code injection technique used to attack database server. SQL injection is a code injection technique used to attack database applications. Many ICS systems contain a backend database system to store data. In SQL injections attack, malicious SQL statements are inserted into entry field for execution. Example, to dump the database content to the attacker. The SQL injection technique is commonly used to exploit security vulnerability in an application software. For example, an attacker can embed a escape character in SQL statement sent to a vulnerable a database application that can result in unexpected command execution. The embed escape character change the meaning of the characters which follow it, resulting in the execution of command. SQL injection is commonly employed as an attack vector on website with backend database, but the technique can be used to attack other type of SQL database as well. Now friends, man in the middle or MTTM or MIM attacks occur with the attacker secretly eavesdropping, rely and or alter the electronic communication between two parties. To successfully execute this attack, the attacker must be able to intercept massive I think sometimes I saw some lag, so I was thinking if my screen is hanged or what. Thanks for confirming. So attacker must be able to intercept message passing between the two parties or victims and alter the content or inject new content between these. So for example, if an attacker is within the reception range of an uninterrupted Wi-Fi wireless access point, he or she can electronically insert himself as a man in the middle and establish an independent connection with the victims and relay message between the between them. Now a successful man in the middle attack makes the victim believe that they are talking directly to each other over a private connection, wherein the fact is the entire conversation is controlled by the attacker. So now let's try to understand our next generation cyber security, right? So here we are talking about the difference in depth of it, right? And that is actually a kind of move towards building our cyber immune systems. So friends, so how it happens is architecture is getting into layers of defenses, and anybody can come using their devices, their device network, or they come through the. Oh, I'm so sorry, I was on mute. Let me go back and explain again. I'm so sorry. Just a second, let me go back. Okay, so friends, now we are going to talk about our the actual the topic what we have targeting for throughout this session is to generate our own next generation cybersecurity architecture, and how, what are the things we should consider and how we can make it after learning from our human immune systems, right? So I was just explaining before a few terminologies, few methodologies which may help you to understand the the concept which may help you to understand certain things. So that's what I explained earlier. But now here, now this is actual kind of a move towards our building a cyber immune systems. Now, so how it happens, friend, is in is architecture is getting into layers of defenses, and anybody, either come from a user, devices or applications, they come through that multiple layer. What is really give importance is to identify user context, right? So friends, here we are talking about the identification of that user. We are not focusing much on the authorization, right? So we really give importance to identify user context, identify the network and the text, and identify the all environment context. So that very important thing for us on the basis of identification is we give them an access to the to provision that resource, and that's going to be a very robust mechanism of security monitoring and orchestration for each layer, and each layer give input to another layer, and that's try to make this all control, and which becomes more efficient because of the robust integration and orchestration. And surely this is going to be a good step if we try to mimic the human immune systems, right? Let me try to go much deeper into it. So so here if you can see, the next gen security architecture relies on multiple security controls at each of the depicted layer to assess the risk and secure our application and data in a coordinated manner in a platform-centric digital environment. Trust is established at each layer. Friends, here I am talking about the trust. If there is a trust is not there, then probably we can go for some other authentication factor. Maybe we can go for some two-factor authentication and all. But trust is established at each layer based on the context that the trust is explicitly and dynamically calculated based on that context. The overarching security monitoring and orchestrating layer for continuous monitoring and assessment of the entity, that is either it's coming from the user, devices or apps. Now over a duration of interaction and accordingly access capability should be adopted, or probably we can remove this entirely. So this is all about the identity of that particular device user, right? So this is the this is step is towards mimicking our human immune systems. Now friends, here we are considering a certain kind of approach. Like one approach we are considering is a very well known from the Gartner, which is CARTA approach, which is continuous adaptive risk and trust assessment. And we have that is from Gartner, and we have a Google implementation of BeyondCorp or Zero Trust, right? So these are the two approach we are considering here as the next design principles. So CARTA and Beyond Trust, these are the reference points where we are displaying here, which is a way towards building a cyber immune system. So what happened actually is, friends, is access will be based on least privilege principle and need to know basis only, which is very known principle in security, and irrespective of a profile location and device, we will give a secure access to people. I will identify the user, and depend on the context, we give the authentication. So for the importance here is not authentication, importance here is identification. So basic philosophy is that if you are able to identify the person, there is no need to ask them for the authentication, like password or two-factor authentication only. Now in case we have any doubt about anything, then we can step up. we can step up and ask for the authentication. Then access will be given to the respective places, like someone wants to access a place which given to access which will give access to that particular user only, or lateral movement will try to restrict, in short, through a mechanism which we called as a micromanagement. Now today what we are doing or what we are considering here is like micromanagement. In case of a micromanagement, we are actually doing segmentation of the business. When business is in one segment and another is on another segment, so we are making sure that one segment does not go, in case of any infection happen, then infection or activity or malicious activity happen on one segment that does not go to another segment. And in case of a micro segment, it's all about the server segment, where the servers talk to another server only when is needed or when is there any requirement. Now here we can put certain restriction that why is required to talk to particular server, why up to what time, and what will be the we can create a checklist kind of a thing where based on the requirement we can access we can give the access to some other server. So this is what we are doing as a part of a micro segmentation. And whether a specific requirement lateral movement is strictly prohibited, and that is what we called as a as I explained in a micro segment. And what happens is all the payload which is coming inside through one gateway, ever told you, will be inspected and sanitized from any malware infection or data leak, which is very important. Though it's kind of difficult to achieve, but what is required to have in for this architecture, but there will be a real-time dynamic threat monitoring and response capability that will be deploying proactively, which deal with cyber security threats that's going to be helpful as per this next-gen design principles. So friends, I have taken certain points from Gartner, so that I'm going to share with you. So Gartner's continuous adaptive risk and trust mechanism, CRTA approach, the continuous is a basically strategic approach to the IT security that favors continuous cyber security assessment. And of course, that is contextual decision making based on the adaptive evaluation of risk and trust, right? So this is what these are the things what we have adopt from the human system. We are continuously monitoring, we are continuously assessing, and trying, and based on the evaluation of the risk and trust, we do certain actions. So CATA was introduced by the Gartner in 2010 as an evaluation of its adaptive secure architecture, and basically prevention and detections are the key pillar here of a traditional approach to cyber security. Now in the digital world, however, predicting new threat and automating routine cyber security response and practice to free up the time of human specialist for most complex incident, right? And these are the key to staying ahead of an expanding universe of threat and risk, right? So these are the few points what I have taken from the Gartner sites only. You can refer the source I am sharing here. And moreover, relying only on the on prevent and detect perimeter, as I mentioned in, earlier, defenses, the rule-based security such as antivirus and firewall, that are the one cases, right? Because less effective, and as organizations increasingly use cloud-based systems and open application programming interface APIs to create modern business ecosystems, the IT department simply does not control the bound of an organization information and technology in the way it used to it. Therefore, the current incident response mindset of any organization which views security incident as an one-off event must shift to a continuous responses or continuous response instances. The assumption must be that the organization will be compromised, that is, hacker's ability to penetrate systems is never fully countered. Continuous monitoring of a systems and behavior is the only way to reliably detect threat before it is too late. So this is about the Gartner's data. And now this is about Google Beyond Trust implementation. This is taken from the Google sites. I have shared the source also. So Beyond Corp is a Google's implementation of a zero trust security model that built up 8 years of building zero trust network at Google's only. So combining with ideas and best practice from the community by shifting access controls from the network perimeter to individual users and devices, Beyond Corp allow employee or any contractor or any other user to work more securely from virtually any location without the need of for a traditional VPN. So that's what the demand of our current time, where people want to work more efficiently from anywhere. People is not, now the employees are not required to work from office. They can work from any place, and there will be a no requirement of their use of any traditional VPN because order allowed. Now, to explain this further, we'll be having simply secure access to the internal apps, and that is being described by keep workers productivity. So what are these? Are the basically some benefits? So basically this kind of approach will help employees, contractors and partners stay productive with access to internal web apps from anywhere on virtually any device. In terms of a retain control, enforce per application access control based on user identity, right? So this is what we are going into granular level, right? So device status, location and other attribute to increase security, and that's of course going to reduce the risk as well. And of course the one of the important benefit I would say is deploy quickly, and this enable remote access in days versus the month it takes to deploy what we have in our traditional way of doing things. Now access will be based on, as I said, in a least privilege principles and need to know basis. One way to limit access to various part of our network is by user privilege. User should be only be provided those privilege required to perform the duty as prescribed in their job description. So it's going to be some kind of a restriction, right? So information and communication technology ICT security manager should limit the number of privileged account for such essential role as systems or database administrator. And then of course monitoring user activities, especially sensitive information and privilege account actions, that is while creating new accounts, meaning password, etc. And that should be a part of the day-to-day operation of information and communication technology ICT management group. Access will be provided in a seamless, transparent manner to ensure a good experience. All users, irrespective of their profile, irrespective of their location and devices, will have a secure, logical path to access enterprise resource from any network. Effective identification mechanism must exist for users, application, IT systems or devices. The strategy and the strength and complexity of user authentication will be based on risk level for the requesting user and the IT resources or data access being requested. All applications, microservices will be secure by design and will follow secure change management process. This is one of the very important factors. All have to be through change management process. I mean all the security, right? All any service and data access request will be logged and of course monitored to enable all the traceabilities. That is also one of the key points, right? All the payloads will be inspected and sanitized for any malware infected and any kind of data leaks. Real-time dynamic threat monitoring and response capability will be deployed proactively, and that is with dealing with cyber security threats. Now friends, here I am just explaining quickly about the data journey. So if we talk about a user journey to data lake, so there is a browser through which user entered, and user will pass through a next generation firewall that will inspect the various threat if there is any malware, DDoS attack, all sort of things. Like it will come to the access gateway, where robust access gateway host we are talking about the robust access gateway, host access gateway, which will be used our identity access management. The access gateway will see that what is the context here, what is the context of the access, and depending upon the context, it will step for if there is any authentication required, and that is required for some time, it will be asked for the authentication. Like second factor authentication, then this authenticated user come inside, then that will be tested for any web application threat using web application firewall WAF. Then it will come to our API gateway, where technologies like the WSO2 will look at the API threat. Then it will come to our SDN, which will do our, as I mentioned, the micro segmentation for us, and that will come to a business application. And business application there is completely DevSecOps kind of integration. A pipeline is there, and that will scan all the application at the time of deployment. It goes to the pipeline and make sure that security is built at the time of a design stage only, and itself. Going to the data lake, then is going to be a hello. Okay, sorry, I was just thinking. Now before going to the data lake, there is a layer of production we called as a Knox, KNOX, which does the authentication, and then there is a Ranger which gives the access control to the finally our data lake. That is how it's happened to the user in overall data context. So if we try to summarize this, network traffic is inspected for various threats such as a malware, DDoS attack, network exploit, etc. User access request is redirected to IDM for device profiling and authentication. User access is maintained during the interaction. User device are authenticated, risk-based authentication performed. Traffic from authentication user inspected for a web attack. And if user access request is through API and WSO2 authentication and authorize the API, SDN layer allow only legitimate traffic to the required host. Access is provided to the user as per the authorization label defined within the application, and access request to data lake for application is through the Knox, and access request to data lake from application is authorized at Ranger, and user get access to the required data. So this is about the data journey. Now functional architecture, if I'm talking about the functional architecture, as I told you, there is a gateway layer. In the gateway, there is an access gateway, there is a next generation firewall, there is a sandboxing environment, take care of the zero-day threats. Then your data prevention, digital rights management, and web application firewall. If I'm talking about authorization and authentication layer, the Azure Active Directory, Azure AD, Enterprise Identity Server provides single sign-on multi-factor authentication to help protect your user from any cyber security attacks. Friends, these are the, I think the time is also about to finish, it's almost 8 now. So I think these are the things, this functional architecture is very self-explanatory. Let me just quickly jump to my next slide, which is a conclusion. So now coming to the last one on the cyber immune system, the important part is like the entropy of the cyber immune systems, also like the way human immune systems that becomes poor after some times due to somebody's age increase. Same way that in a cyber security we have a wear and tear, so that may lead to cyber immune systems too. And in human system, somebody abuse somebody, don't follow the minimum hygiene requirement, and that may lead to his health. Similarly, in our cyber immune systems, we also face this kind of a system, this kind of a environment, or this kind of a practice. Friends, I believe no cyber security sessions end up, especially if we are covering the awareness, then there must be some topic for education and awareness. Let me just quickly go through it. So awareness campaign is one of the important thing. So that emphasizes the lesson learned through education and training can assist greatly into keeping employee aware of their obligation to remain vigilant against becoming a victim of any cyber attack. Multiple things cannot expect all if the employee is aware. So we'll be having a last month October, which will be a cyber security awareness month. I'm sure people are must be doing so many things while participating in different activities in your respective organization and doing this cyber security awareness month. And the easiest way to do this is to have the information, to acknowledge the any attacks to your respective information risk management team, or if in case you find anything suspicious, or even if you think that is a genuine but you have a little bit of doubt, you can go back and it's no harm to checking with your experts. And always complete any recommended training shared by your organizations. So this education and awareness, if I say, is playing a critical role if you're talking about any cyber immune systems. And of course, enhancing the resilience of the ICT infrastructure can be achieved through the appropriate combination of security measure to address the intentional or unintentional exploit to malicious software or malware, right? So this is how I was trying to compare or create two immunity systems. One is a cyber immune system and another one is a human immune systems, and try to explain what are the things we can learn from them and what are the things we can increase or enhance in our cyber immune systems. I'm sure there are so many other things which probably I may not be able to cover in these sessions, but there are a lot of things we can learn from the immune system, their behavior, how to having behave in certain situations, what are the incident response, how our body reacts, and how to react, in fact. So these are a few topics probably. In fact, there are so many other topics which I will definitely will try to cover probably in the next session if we have any. So thanks for being with me, friends. During this session, it's been my pleasure to join you for this journey.